question which is connected with the decimal mathematics. They ask this question, number one, are we selected by people, are we selected by forces, are we selected by a power? It is very interesting to know, if we have a job, a rational and natural way of thinking is, I have selected a job. If somebody has opted for engineering, they think that they have selected engineering. It is a natural, common, obvious way. And in spiritual way, or as per discipline mathematics, you have not selected that, and that answers that, that particular division has selected you. That particular thing has opted you. And instead of your intervention into your own activities as per your own desire and design, there is an intervention of a second force, apart from all of your visible forces, like trend analysis, market analysis, then management, administration, then organizational behavior, then investment mechanics, fund management, resources management. In spite of having all of these visible trends without any flaw, there is something which is guiding you, there is something which is deviating you, there is something that is intervening in your way, apart from whatever the thing that you consider as a perceptible tool for your development and survival. So this type of understanding of selection, option and intervention in two dimensions. Are we selected, are we opted, are we intervened in spite of all perfect and precise in our status? Number one. Number two, can we have an option, selection and intervention? So there are two dimensions of these things. One is energy physics or entrepreneurship, and second thing is gestural mathematics or the law of karma or predeterminism. And one has to manage both of these things to understand as well as arrive at a proper way of measuring his life status and leading the same without fail. So this particular area that has resulted in understanding of life by five major rules. Number one is law of binding. That is a law by which each and every person is committed to his previous action, the impact of which binds and distrains the furtherance. Each and everybody's further action or the impact for his present actions are determined and distrained by the cyclic link of previous imprints and impulses. So it is known as law of binding. Second is known as law of qualification. Law of qualification says that there are innumerable methodologies by which a person can observe fasting, certain rites, contemplative methodologies, certain systems of observing celibacy, austerity, mystic practices, and getting supernatural accomplishments. A person can have a qualification breaking the rules of demarcations of bindings. That is known as the rule of qualification. The third thing is the rule of subtle refinement, that is what we call samskaras. If a person has to get a proper stage development, what is stage development? A person born, he must be hale and healthy. A student must be intellectually salubrious. And harmony is the benefit of matrimonial relations. Harmony and progeny is the fruit of matrimonial relations. Development, all-round happiness, success and progress, these are all the fruits of business. So all of these things are not only governed by tangible things but also by subtle refinements. They are known as samskaras. So the shastras say that there are samskaras like jata karma, upanayana, and vivaha itself is a samskara. So considering something as a social contract or as a blind ceremonial ritual, understanding the purport and purpose of the ritual with the fullest meaning, and have a divine and contemplative attachment with each and every movement of the society that makes the person to get utmost benefits. That is known as the rule of subtle refinement or samskara suddhi. The fourth is the rule of second focus. If you cannot get something, if something is not meant for you, for example, if something is not achieved, immediately there are a lot of people who will be depressed. There are a lot of people who will go for even suicidal motivation. There are a lot of people who will be totally de-socialized, disqualified to live in this society. There are a lot of people who will have a blow of thunder or lightning and it is just momentary. They will re-equip themselves and come to the normalcy. And there are a lot of people who just throw these things away and re-equip themselves with an alternative or substitution, which is a dimension of a survival theory, alternative and substitution. It is a very vital medulla oblongata for survival mechanism. So this type of rule is known as the rule of second focus. If you don't get something, you go for alternative. There are a lot of other things available. There are a lot of people, those who achieved in the society, in science, in athletics, in media, in industrialism, and various other dimensions, a lot of people are there, in spite of their failures, a lot of people withstood. And a lot of people, they totally abdicated their previous stage and entered a new, fresh area, then mastered, achieved, and they are living with enormous repute. So innumerable such models are there available, living models and inspiration models are available. Both history and society has provided a collection of varieties of such people in various industries or various dimensions. If something is not there, you contemplate on something else. Great people, those who achieved in mega dimensions, like social development and scientific development, personally in their family life or in the sub-society level, those people, they have proved their failure. They have successfully failed in their sub-society level, but in the society level, they have proved their excellence. So this is known as the rule of second focus. If you don't have the thing, you opt for the same thing for a second time. If you don't have a thing, you offer something different, something distinct, something that is essential for the society and achieve it. It is known as rule of second focus. And rule of intuitive dividends and rule of distant communication or subjective communication, these two things are very much essential in life management. I think that we have conducted workshops on that and there is not a lecture. Rule of intuitive guidance. How to know about things? Experience things which are just tabulated or filtered upon your or others' experience, they are just blind. If somebody cheats you, then that experience induces your caution and also it paints all people, it brands all people in the name of fraudulence. If some benefit you get, if you get a trace of benefit, then that pinch of benefit that brands everything as fortune to you. For example, in gambling, in horse riding and various other issues, whatever infinitesimal or a scintillating spark that they receive, that makes a person to tempt, to go for everything as beneficial. If a person is totally deceived in a particular atmosphere, that makes a person to totally deal everything in a deceptive model or a deceptive frame. So, intuitive guidance, it gives you a proper way of filtration by which you can analyze where to believe, how much to believe, how long to believe, and what are the selective issues, what are the rational factors that we have to take for our guidance that can be promptly and properly given only by intuitive guidance. I have already told, by your experience, education is useless. By reading in papers, you cannot just do nothing in the practical life, either in business or in organization management. Your paper experience will not come for rescue. Your personal experience is limited. Paper experience is crude. So, divine experience or intuitive experience is the proper and precise guide. So, to repeat it, paper experience is crude. It is raw material. Personal experience is limited and unilateral or unidirective in nature. So, intuitive guidance. How to develop intuition? Intuition is already there in everybody, and to become a good receptacle or a reflector plane of that intuition, that must be constituted by ethical precision and universal love. We know all of these qualities. We know all of these qualities and we have heard them even in the first standard fables and fairy tales and stories even. So how to instill the same thing and how to make a process by which we can be ethically vaccinated. That is known as ethical vaccination. We used to call it as ethical vaccination. So to get a sturdy model in which we tenaciously grip to the principles which we know, which we think, which we dream, which we plan to have, but which we cannot due to various other diversions and centripetal and centripetal and centri